Sponsored by Alien Clothing.
Okay, let's get to these games. What does everybody like to play?
Bottom line, guys, if you don't like it here, go back.
Oh boy, do I have a treat for you all today. I do love me a movie that tries to make a point or address an important issue, but fails spectacularly. They're great because not only are they comedy gold, but they give me the opportunity to say something beyond just movie bad. And what's better than a failed message movie? A failed message movie based on a meme! We all know how great meme movies inevitably turn out to be, so we've already got plenty of indication that this one is going to be extra spicy. Because this one is based on the Karen meme.
If you've spent any time on the internet during the blighted hellscape of the last 2 years, you know what a Karen is. But for the sake of clarity and extra mid-roll ads, I'm going to elaborate anyway. A Karen is a usually but not exclusively white, usually but not exclusively middle-aged woman who aggressively bullies other people in order to get her own way and satisfy her sense of self-entitlement.
Speaking as someone who spent years working in customer service, these bitches are the worst. No, you cannot have the seafood ramen without seafood, Karen. True story.
The most notorious type of Karen, and the one this movie is concerned with, is the white middle-aged racist woman who freaks out every time a minority breathes too loudly, and at her most chilling, employs her status as a white woman to play the victim and use the authorities against the person of color she's opposing.
I'm gonna tell them there's an African-American man threatening my life. There is an African-American man, I am in Central Park, he is recording me and threatening myself and my dog. I'm being threatened by a man in the Ramble! Please send the cops immediately!
Awareness of Karens and intolerance for their bullshit have both skyrocketed over the last few years. And the popularity of the meme even led to 2020 being called the Year of the Karen. The meme took on special significance in conjunction with the rise of the Black Lives Matter movement, as Karen incidents were seen as another example of how police brutality can be weaponized against the people of color that it disproportionately affects. Now, I'm not here to declare myself king of the oppressed or give you a lecture on the very real and complex issue of racism. I don't feel qualified to do that, and that's not what this channel's about.
But I do know shitty movies, and I know when a movie is trying to say something, but says it badly. Because when you make a movie about this sensitive and oh-so-important topic, of course you'd base it on a meme. What could possibly go wrong?
What the hell are you doing here?
Is that any way to speak to a neighbor?
The makers of Karen must think that nuance refers to some obscure French source, because it handles its subject matter with all the subtlety of a car crash. Everything, from the characterization, dialogue, plot points, music choices, lighting, everything, is so heavy-handed and so ridiculous that you just can't take any of it seriously.
Come on, girlfriend. Come on, girlfriend! Let's do this!
Literally the first shot of the movie is the Karen washing away some BLM graffiti, and it never gets any less on the nose. We also never find out who wrote the graffiti, and it never comes up again, which is going to be another running theme. Its presentation of these very real and important issues is so shallow and reductive that it says nothing beyond the obvious, and actually ends up being counterproductive. And this starts with the Karen herself, who is even called Karen. And in case you were too stupid to notice that brilliant bit of irony, they point it out 3 f***ing times!
Wait a minute, we have a white entitled neighbor named Karen?
So Karen is a Karen. Boy, God has a sense of humor. Bro, she's a Karen named Karen. It's like God knew she was gonna be evil.
And this Karen really isn't that much of a Karen, all things considered. They could have gone much harder with the stereotypes. They didn't even give her the classic "Can I speak to the manager?" haircut. Maybe they thought that would be a bit much, which is odd because it's not like they're being subtle about anything else. Aside from a couple of instances, she doesn't behave how stereotypical Karens normally do. She also doesn't act like a normal human being. In fact, they've basically made her into a cartoon villain. Which would be fine if they'd gone down the supernatural horror route and made her a monster, similar to, say, the other mother from Coraline. Hell, I'd have watched that. But they didn't. So she's not the stereotype, she's not a monster, and her character and motivations are all over the place. I'm absolutely not denying that Karens or racists exist, but does the writer really think that Karens sit around in dark rooms wringing their hands and going,
"Black people, black people"?
At least they recognize how absurd this is.
Oh my goodness, this sounds like something straight out of SNL.
It's more like Black Mirror.
Yeah, don't name drop those things. You're trying to punch way above your weight.
And then he sent this video.
Oh. You son of a bitch! You ruined my life!
Luigi, no!
He's got a red turtle shell!
I take that back.
It's fairly obvious that they were trying to emulate Get Out, except that unlike them, Jordan Peele actually knows what he's doing. They employ some of the conventions of horror, like extreme close-ups and that shitty violin music you always hear in horror films, but they do it where it doesn't make sense, or they do it badly.
Let's leave my f***ing family alone. Get off my property, Karen.
No problem.
It's somewhat fitting that the writer-director's name is Coke, as I'm assuming that's where most of the budget went. Because the script is a goddamn mess, and the writing is laughably bad. Plot devices are introduced and then completely forgotten about. Multiple plot threads that could have been interesting to explore are left completely undeveloped. It seems like they just threw a bunch of ideas and tropes at the wall to see what stuck, with a result that's trying to be as broad as a river but just ends up being as shallow as a puddle of piss. The story is slow, boring, and horribly paced. Until the last 10 minutes, when it abruptly goes from 10 to 100. At least it doesn't overstay its welcome at only an hour and 20 minutes, but even that feels desperately stretched out. The characters are two-dimensional at best, and aside from the poorly cast Taryn Manning, who does a fair job with what she was given, the performances are pretty lackluster. Corey Hardrick is particularly flat as the husband, like he really didn't want to be there, which is understandable. And just listen to some of this dialogue.
Tell me about your new neighbors.
Hey, they're black.
Really?
What?
They did leave their trash out on the curb.
After the trash had been picked up?
Yes.
That is not a good start.
Oh no, the horror! If you told a bunch of school kids to put on a play about racism, this is what it would sound like. When you combine these issues with some really poor execution and bizarre filmmaking choices, this serious crime drama thriller turns out to be unintentionally hilarious.
Hey girl.
If I didn't know that this movie was written and directed by a black man for a black network, I would have assumed that this was making fun of the people who don't like racist Karens. Which means they f***ed it up. If it was trying to be satirical, then it provides neither original biting commentary nor humor. Except for the wrong reasons.
Hey.
Whoa, sh**.
This stuff is so strong.
Look, Cameron, you can't be popping behind vans and hopping out on me like that now.
And it takes itself way too seriously for these instances to be intentionally funny. So what we end up with is a big old pile of cringe that'll make you want to suck your teeth back into your throat. It's a dumpster fire of unintended comedy that's sometimes painful to sit through. But I watched it anyway, because this is my life now. But before we get deeper into it, I have to give a shout out to this video's sponsor, Sick Threads. No, it's actually sponsored by my friend Elvis the Alien, who also made a video on Karen. I'm not mad though. I'm not. Back in 2017, he started an indie streetwear clothing company called Alien. And with the love and support of the YouTube community, it's now grown beyond his wildest dreams. Elvis created it specifically for people like him who enjoy movies, games, anime, and anything science fiction related. So it's right up my alley. With Alien, you can be bold and embrace your weirdness through their amazing designs that are very carefully created by some of the best artists from around the world. Including this little number, which, well, how could I resist? Alien uses only the best quality fabrics available on the market while still doing their best to keep every item affordable, with items being printed, shipped, and handled with care by their team in Canada. They're even being sold by popular Canadian skate shop Zoomies, and they hope to expand more in the future, which is exciting. I've worn alien clothing in multiple videos that I've made, so I can attest to their excellent quality. So grab what you can before it's sold out, because most items are never restocked. But don't worry, Alien is constantly coming out with new creative designs. And you can save 20% off anything in the store by using the code CYNICAL at checkout, with free shipping on any orders over $100. So head over to alienclothing.com to stay spaced out and never compromise your sense of self again. And thanks to Alien Clothing for sponsoring the video. That's very nice of them. Now back to the racism. The movie follows married couple Malik and Imani, who have just moved into a neighborhood in which they're the first black couple because change has to start somewhere. We're supposed to sympathize with them throughout what follows, but they have no romantic chemistry and their dialogue is next level bad.
You are a strong, beautiful, intelligent, and woke black man.
You can't make this up. This defies parody.
I mean, you're beautiful, intelligent, sexy, college educated, socially aware, and on top of that, a strong, beautiful black woman.
Who talks like this? That couple in the lemon stealing whores video was more endearing.
I wish I was a lemon.
You wish you were a lemon? If you were a lemon, I would put you on my shelf and cherish you like I cherish all our lemons.
That's so beautiful. Hey, has it been about 10 seconds since we looked at our lemon tree?
It has been about 10 seconds till we looked at our lemon tree.
Hey,
what the fuck?
You could also play a drinking game with the amount of times they say babe or baby.
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 Baby. Baby.
Hey, baby.
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 Baby. Yes, babe.
Hi, babe.
They're also kinda assholes themselves.
Hi. She seems nice.
Yeah, I'm sure. Real nice.
She didn't even do anything. All she did there was say hello, and they're just like, ugh. But Karen quickly puts up cameras on her house because, you know, she is a racist. Despite having scouted out the neighborhood first and knowing that it's named after a Confederate officer, they seem weirdly taken aback that there are white people there. They also seem to be aware that racism exists and are paranoid about it, but they're constantly surprised whenever they experience it and act like they haven't before. The cognitive dissonance on display is too damn high.
Oh god, I feel old.
Moving on, of course,
there's a lot of courses in this movie.
Karen has a brother who's a cop, with a voice that was built for narrating porn.
Now, don't worry about it.
He didn't even need to be here. They just wanted him to show up at this restaurant, deliver exposition about how he's a cop, and then leave. She gets annoyed at some black guys laughing too loud, and of course she threatens to tell the manager. Although she's being way too polite to qualify as a true Karen. Was that a laugh, or is he choking? What was that? So she tells the manager and gets them kicked out. But why would the manager agree to kick out paying customers for that? They weren't doing anything. But we have to give her the opportunity to do the Karen equivalent of twirling her mustache. While Malik is hotboxing his car, Karen interrupts him to ask him not to smoke weed where her kids might see it, which seems reasonable enough. But since she's so concerned with policing black people, it's odd that she's okay with weed at all. When he goes in the house, Imani notices the weed smell.
Your wife doesn't know, does she?
No, she doesn't.
Surprising she didn't know about this before, since he's doing such a piss-poor job of hiding it. He even has the munchies, which would be adorable if he weren't a dick about it.
Indeed, indeed. What's for dinner, babe? Babe, dinner?
They then start awkwardly stripping each other while their curtains are open. I don't care who you are, that's weird. Close your f***ing curtains. Because anyone could just stand there and rub one out to you. Oh, wait. Oh, come on, why did they have to give him a Mastodon poster? Looks like Karen's got a case of the munchies herself. In one of the very few subplots that becomes relevant outside of the scene it's mentioned in, the couple has been trying to conceive, but without success. Their post-coital commiserations are interrupted by noises outside.
Maybe should we call the police?
No, I am the police.
Whoa, watch out, guys, we got a badass over here.
Is that Kelly?
camera pointing directly at our house?
It's looking right at us, babe.
Why are you surprised by this? You stood there and watched her install it. Imani goes next door to tell Karen to move the camera, which is the first time the couple has made any attempt to interact with anybody in the neighborhood. Karen then lets her know about the curtain thing, just to make things awkward.
Well, just let me know your schedule.
Oh, was that not meant to be funny? Malik then plays a bit of one-on-one with Karen's son.
I put that D on you, come on, what?
That was a really poor choice of words. This is all the development the son gets, and we never see him again. Karen asks for Malik's help and then tries to get a bit of blacked.com.
It's so hard.
She invites him into her house to clean himself up, and he reluctantly agrees. How is this not the start of a porno? I'm really surprised that she would leave him alone in her house if she was such a massive racist. And why can't he wash his hands in his own house? He lives literally next door! All this just so he can stumble into her CIA surveillance room. This is so contrived and stupid. Oh, come on, how is this not a parody? In fact, if she was that much of a racist, she'd have more Confederate sh** lying around. But we gotta have that trailer shot. I'm also surprised they didn't give her a Blue Lives Matter flag, seeing as how her brother's a cop and all. You'd think that'd be a no-brainer.
Karen, she's watching us, babe.
But you knew that already, for f**k's sake. At least they acknowledge how stupid that setup was. He really is an idiot. Imani buys a camera to point back at Karen's house. The home security salesman, who looks like a younger Snoop Dogg, flirts with her, which lets us see how important loyalty is to her. Except that the potential infidelity subplot gets completely dropped at this point, so it's irrelevant. Because Karen's husband died and she's a stay-at-home mum, not sure how that's financially possible in her situation, but okay. She has way too much time on her hands, so of course she's the head of the Homeowners Association. Those hotbeds of nosy naggers with no personalities beyond their petty ego trips. She starts exaggerating about the involuntary exhibitionism and the husband's weed.
Listen, they just moved in. And we need more people of color in the neighborhood.
Ones that can afford it.
That's a bit of a weird comment, seeing as how the couple managed to get the mortgage, so they obviously can afford it.
What happens is it starts with weed. Next thing you know, we have criminals coming into our neighborhood. Then we've got pimps and prostitutes. Then you're having black babies, can you imagine?
Ah yes, we all know that marijuana is the gateway drug to black babies. Wait, why are black babies worse than pimps and criminals? I mean, I hate kids too, but what? We have Louis C.K. at home, and the other members of the HOA disagree with her. And I'm not joking, this is the very next shot. How are we not supposed to laugh at this? After nothing personal kidding behind Imani, she makes like a robot imitating human speech to get herself invited to the couple's housewarming.
Awesome sauce.
Awesome sauce indeed.
There she is slaving away in the kitchen.
Oh.
They shot the man 6 times just for reaching for his wallet like his life didn't even matter.
Huh. Black lives matter.
That's right.
Don't all lives matter?
Oh, fuck. All you people watching at home right now, how do you think this conversation is gonna go? Yep, that's exactly how it goes.
Okay, well, I come from a family of law enforcement, and I know that bad things happen to people that don't comply.
Bad things happen to black people, you mean?
Pull the race card.
Race card?
We've been oppressed and held captive on this foreign land.
And here we go with the whole slavery thing.
If you don't like it here, go back.
These are all things that people do actually say, but this is like the worst kind of Facebook comment thread. Every commenter is a one-dimensional stereotype, and this interaction is so awkward to watch that it's hard to pay attention. Again, if she were as big a racist as she's supposed to be, there's no way she'd walk alone into the middle of a house full of black people. This makes even less sense when we get more information on her background later in the movie. Malik is understandably a bit annoyed at his wife for inviting Karen. And Imani decides that now's not a good time to have kids because of so much racism in the world. How did you not know that before? Oh, and apparently they now have financial problems? Why would they buy this house and try to have a child if they weren't financially stable? This just makes them look really irresponsible. And of course it never gets explained or brought up again.
It's not the right time.
You know what? You get your shit together.
Get my shit.
Wow, guilt-tripping your wife for not wanting to get pregnant. That's a good look.
Trash day's tomorrow, not today.
Was that supposed to be intimidating? Look at this. They've obviously tried to cover up identifiable markings on the bin with mud, but then realized that that would look weird. So instead, they made it look like somebody smeared their diarrhea all over it. Priorities. Karen's daughter comes out to help her. She's not a racist and even has a black boyfriend. It could have been interesting to explore how that affects her relationship with her mum, but nope, that gets immediately dropped as well. And we never see her again either. Karen and Imani tell each other to f*** off, and then Karen calls the cops on some young men walking through the neighbourhood, which is surprisingly one of the more realistic scenes in the movie. But then while Karen stands on the street outside looking in like a cartoon Gestapo agent, the couple talk about racism in a way that, from what I've been told by people of colour who've seen this, is not how people of colour talk about racism in private. There's only so much realism this movie can take, after all. Karen and Cop Bro have an expository conversation that amounts to, "Mer, we're racist, mer." And then since the HOA is being sued by the father of one of the boys, who's a prominent civil rights attorney, they kick Karen out. She hears the phrase Black Lives Matter and immediately vomits, like it's her kryptonite or something. Oh yeah, she now gets sick and it's never, like, addressed or explained. Cool. Cop Bro pulls Malik over and plants weed in his car. This scene starts off really tense and uncomfortable to watch, over-the-top music notwithstanding.
How did we go from whips and chains to whips and chains?
But then it goes off the rails. Cop Bro punches him, so he headbutts him back. He's right to be angry, but assaulting a cop, especially a racist one who's just looking for an excuse? Black people have been killed by cops for way less than that, as messed up as that is. It feels like they gave him plot armor, and it ruins whatever message they were trying to convey here by being unbelievably unrealistic. He also would not be let out that quickly if he'd done something like that, let's just be honest. Karen sits on Imani's car to establish dominance and tells her she should
get out,
but she decides that they're not going anywhere. So they go talk to the civil rights lawyer.
Charges never stick. You see, he belongs to a secret society of cops. They protect each other.
They don't need a secret society. The police protect their own anyway. That's how it works. I get that they didn't want to go with an all cops are bastards message, which is why they have the good cop who confronts Cop Bro. But blaming it on a secret cabal of bad apples seems like an attempt to ignore the wider issue. Which is very weird of a film like this to do, right? Like, I can't be the only one that thinks that. It also can't be much of a secret society if this lawyer knows about it. It's also here we find out that Karen became an insane racist after her husband was killed by a black vigilante. There's another potentially interesting topic that they bring up and then just go, oh, okay. They already told us that her racism started as the result of crime and drugs in her childhood neighborhood. So why even bother to give her this other reason if they're just gonna hand wave it away? Cop Bro gets a search warrant, they never say what for, and arrests Malik for having a gun. Though they never specify that he doesn't have a license, and in Georgia, where this is set, you don't even need to have a license to have a gun in your house, so this makes no sense. But f*** it, they just wanted to have a home arrest scene. And it is insanely melodramatic and with atrocious editing. It's an excuse to get Malik out of the house so Karen can cut the power and break in to kill Imani. Told you this escalates really quickly. I have no words. Why is she not running as soon as she sees the gun? And where is all the red lighting in the house coming from? And of course there's a thunderstorm.
We have a report of shots fired at 888 Miranda Way.
No, not the donuts. What is this music? It's so inappropriate and the editing is awful. She couldn't beat up Karen while she was on top of her and she had a leg wound? What? Why are you standing there? F***ing run!
Fine, I'll f***ing shoot!
They weren't trying to make that funny, but they could have fooled me. Good cop shows up and shoots the bad cop. Karen's about to shoot the good cop, but Imani kills her first. And then we cut to this guy giving a speech. And why is this guy playing a trumpet? What is happening right now?
Your silence is compliance.
But throughout the movie, other characters challenged Karen and Bad Cop on their bullshit, and Imani was even saved by a white cop. So who exactly was being silent and compliant? They even stare directly into the camera, because profound. And Imani got pregnant in the end, so I guess they all live happily ever after. What happened to Karen's two kids? Who f***ing cares? They're white. And rather than end the movie on a list of black people unjustly killed by the police and their stories, the fact that this has its own Wikipedia article, fucking hell, which would directly relate this story to real-life events, no! Let's cut to credits with a dancing woman that looks like an iPod commercial or a shitty Bond intro and has nothing to do with the movie's themes. We did it, boys! We killed racism! There were some good ideas here and a lot of potential, but it was all wasted. Karen could have been a lot more interesting if it had just fully embraced the horror route or not taken itself too seriously. Or maybe if they'd done a more in-depth exploration of the psychology of a Karen and the effects of her actions both on herself and the person she victimizes. Especially if that person didn't have a famous civil rights hero for a dad to get them out of trouble. In my opinion, that would make for a much more compelling and profound experience. But no, they just wanted to cash in on a meme. Awesome sauce. At least they avoided going down the all white people are racist route, which would have just been false and needlessly alienating. But what they've delivered is a superficial look at racism that ignores a lot of its real-world complexities and subtleties, and just ends up being insulting to the people who experience it or have lost their lives to it. There are many examples of movies or TV shows that handle these topics better and are far more worthy of your time. But if you just want to have a laugh and a good cringe, Karen is good for a drunken watch party.
No, you cannot have the seafood ramen without semen, Karen. Wait, that didn't sound right.
Once again, thanks to Alien Clothing for sponsoring this video. Check them out through the link in the description and pinned comment to get yourself some swag. Thanks also to my supporters on Patreon and my YouTube channel members. Patrons and channel members get early access to uncensored versions of videos without ads or sponsorships, as well as a mention here in the credits. If you feel like it, follow me on my Twitch and my social media and join my public Discord server. All links below. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.